Endurance. How many ever been in maybe some kind of competition, endurance competition? Anybody? You, can you tell us about that competition, that endurance competition? What type of competition was that?
Running.
Running. Okay. And tell me a little bit about, what did you have to do? You just someday woke up and decided, I'm going to do this endurance race, right?
Nope.
it took a little preparation time to prepare for that endurance race, right? Mm-hmm. And the thing is, I think sometimes we think we can just jump into a program and think we're not going to fall when we're not ready for that race. I'd like to show you a little video clip here. It's about the Ironman competition.
To accomplish something extraordinary, one must have an extraordinary dream. A goal so high, a journey so demanding, that its achievement to most seems impossible. For 35 years, Ironman has defined a sport, growing from a single race into a global movement and a new generation of athletes. With over 200 events, Ironman inspires us to reimagine our limits, to set our sights higher, to go farther than we ever have before. Physical toughness and mental strength. Ironman is about persevering, enduring, and being a part of something larger than ourselves. It shows the heights that can be achieved when we push beyond our boundaries and go the distance to earn the title Ironman.
His dad had to actually go on the field and because he pulled a hamstring or something and had to help him across the finish line. And the round of applause and the standing ovation that they gave for that person. And sometimes even the last person, he knew he was the last person and he crawled across the finish line. You know, the important thing is not crossing that finish line the first person. Because there's only one person that's going to cross that line first. But it's that you get across that line. And like I said, last week we talked about having a vision for 2020. And I even got a letter from Mary Wallace and made some comments about what we're going to do to get from here to there. And how many of you this week thought about that? In fact, how many of you wrote down the three things I asked for you to do? Okay, you guys wrote those down? And what is the first one?
Your vision.
Set a goal, right? For Alliance Christian Church, what is your goal? What do you see our church accomplishing in 2020? And then what was the second one?
What personal goal do you have for 2020?
Okay, so what personal goals do you have for 2020? Okay, was that the second one? Was that
That's
the
second.
What's the third one?
What am I willing to accomplish? What am I willing to do to accomplish these goals?
What am I willing to do? Or sometimes it's what am I willing to sacrifice to accomplish my goal, right? And so the thing is, again, we can throw out all kinds of goals, whether it's I want to be financially independent this year, no debt. I'm talking about mortgage, car payments, no debt at all. That all you have is coming in is your monthly bills, electric, you know, gas and food and all that stuff. That'd be a terrific goal. How many of you would like to have a goal like that where you owe no money? In fact, it's a biblical principle, right? It says, owe no man any money. Wow, what a awesome goal. In our society today, that's like, what? Because why? How many of you are old enough to remember a day when there was no such thing as a credit card? Huh? You remember those days? Today we have this thing, well, I only use my credit card for emergencies, right? Uh-huh. And you don't have any cash in your pocket, and someone says, well, let's go out for lunch. Well, I don't have any money, but you don't want to say that, right? So guess what happens? You say, and I remember when I went to Hawaii, we have this, you know, all the relatives are there, right? And who's going to pay, right? That's always the first question. Who's going to pay? And of course, I didn't have any money, but you know what? I wanted to look good. So I said, I'm going to pay. I'm going to buy for everybody. And you know what it's like? I mean, back then, it was pretty cheap, but that was still a lot of money back then. But how many of us have done that is we put our faith and trust in that last thing. When we know we don't have the funds to, I mean, we might get to make the payments, right? I guess I'm glad that I met a guy named Alan Rakovec who taught me a little bit about finances and how to get out of debt. And I'm pursuing that, to get out of debt as quick as possible. How many of you have made that as a goal in life? How many of you have ever accomplished that? Well, were you to the point where you are completely debt-free? You don't owe anybody anything. You know, it is so freeing to be able to do that. Mm-hmm. Because then the extra money that you have is you can help missionaries. You can send money to some Christian cause. You can send money to Wing Wong and Pioneer Bible Translators. And I don't know about you, but I get tons of letters or mailings with people asking for money. World Vision, Compassion International, Todd Becker Foundation. The list can go on and on and on. And when you don't have that extra money, you have to pick and choose on who you're going to support. But when you have a lot of money that God has blessed you with because you honored Him and you have gotten debt free, you can choose to give as much money as you like. You know, but one thing I would like to challenge those of you who have accomplished that debt freeness is go one step further. Make a goal to say, I'm going to trust God to give even more. A while back, many years ago, we had a Bible study, and we studied the treasure principle. And, you know, in our, I guess, our knowledge of how to do giving, we think about the tithe and how important that tithe is, right? In fact, we call it tithes and offerings. Well, the tithe is what? How much? 10%, right? 1/10 of everything you got. Now, some people go, oh, should I give 1/10 of my gross income, or should I give 1/10 of my net income? Hey, don't worry about that stuff, you know? Give. But in the treasure principle, Randy Acorn, in his name, he said there's people that are not just giving 10%, but they, along the way, they said, well, you know, this year I'm going to make a goal to give 20%. I'm going to trust God to give me more. And so the next year they give more. And they realize, hey, that was easy. And so the next year they give more. You know, there's a lot of people that are giving 90% of their income. And they become wealthy because, yeah, they trust in God to bless them for everything they got. And when I think about, you know, here I am with a goal this year to pursue, to get out of debt. It's amazing how the mind works. Where you come up with a plan. I just took a look around at yesterday, and I went in my office at the Young Life Building and I saw this 12-string guitar that I had that someone gave me. And I took a picture and I sent it to Anita to post on Facebook. And you know what? It sold last night. And not only did it sell, and I sold it for cheap, $50 for a 12-string guitar, the guy that bought it, I said, well, you know, I got this other guitar. It's an electric Ibanez, and I'm trying to get rid of that. And I showed it to him, and he played it and everything. And he bought that one, too. I sold that for $150. You see, the thing is, we think that we can control the future by just kind of wandering along the way, when we have to be passionate about whatever goal we have so that we can accomplish those goals. We have to make a plan to get from here to there, like Bill Hybels would say. So the thing is, first of all, what is the most important thing that we have to do as Christians? And when I think about that, I don't know why my, oh, someone turned it off, that's fine. I think about, you know, what Governor Ricketts did this month. How many of you read that, by the way? You guys know about it? Our governor, Pete Ricketts, on the day, the anniversary of Roe versus Wade, made a proclamation. And here's a copy of the proclamation. And I'm going to read it to you. On January 22nd, 1973, the United States Supreme Court issued their Roe versus Wade decision, which legalized abortion in all 50 states. And whereas since Roe versus Wade, over 50 million unborn children have been killed by abortion in the United States. And whereas Nebraska state law states that it is the will of the people of the state of Nebraska and the members of the legislature to provide protection for the life of the unborn child whenever possible. And whereas Nebraska is a pro-life state that respects the dignity of human life, no matter how small, and whereas Nebraskans display our pro-life values in a multitude of ways, from the crisis pregnancy centers that provide free care for expecting parents to the prayer for individuals held across the state every year, and whereas it seems right and fitting that the citizens of the state of Nebraska are urged to pray for the end to for an end to abortion and for our fellow citizens who need our love and support. I, Pete Ricketts, Governor of the State of Nebraska, do hereby proclaim the 22nd day of January 2020 as statewide day of prayer. And he goes on and signs this proclamation. Now, I thought that was pretty bold. And I think we as Christians need to encourage our leaders that stand up for what is right, for the truth. And so I did mention that yesterday at the men's prayer breakfast at the Berean Church. And you know what? One person went one step forward. He actually got a little sentence saying that we applaud you for your support for the unborn child. And he passed that around and had everybody sign that. Wow. You know, the thing is that if we want a change, we have to make a plan. And we have to start putting some things down to say, this is how we're going to get where we want to go. And here's a person that is standing up for the truth, our governor. And I beg you to, if you're really for this, is to write your governor and say, thank you for standing up for what is right. So the thing is, we got to figure out when we're going from here to there is what is the most important thing, or what are we called as Christians to do? In Colossians, the first chapter, Paul the apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timothy a brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ who are at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. We give thanks to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have for all the saints. Now remember, this is not when they used to have instant communication where you can just go posting, right? And today, you know, you can get up on Facebook and you make a post, and people all over the world, your friends all over the world, can see that post, and maybe even some other people might see it too. But the thing is, their communication was, you know, slow, but the word of their faith went clear across the world at that time. It says, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven, of which you previously heard the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you, just as in all the world, also it is constantly bearing fruit and increasing, even as it has been doing in you since the day you heard of it and understood the grace of God in truth. Just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow bondservant, who is the faithful servant of Christ on our behalf. And he also informed us of your love in the Spirit. For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father, who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in life. So what is our goal as Christians? Every single person, if you call yourself Christians, we have been called to do something. We have been called to have the hope of Christ Jesus, the gospel, be spread throughout the world. Every single one of us has the responsibility to, as a disciple of Christ, to spread the word of Jesus Christ. In Hebrews 12, it says, therefore, since we have so great a cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us also lay aside every encumbrance and the sin which so entangles us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. There are people right here in our community that are watching every move that we make. And especially if you call yourselves a Christian,